Good evening. I'm extremely happy to introduce Dr. B.N. Goswamy for today's lecture. Moreover, I'm also very happy that I have to say a few words for him, since I'm one of the biggest fans of his writings and have followed his work since 1982 at the Festival of India in UK, one of the first events where India was showcased outside the world. His works and lectures were most praised amongst not only visitors to the exhibition, but also to the scholars. But before I introduce him, I also would like to say that this is the fourth lecture of the five that Faculty of Alumni Association has decided to conduct at the school for the benefit of students as well as professionals. The sole intention was to create a dialogue and more so enhance the knowledge to everyone in the other fields of other fields rather than architecture. Coming to Dr. Goswamy, in the field of Indian history and in particular Indian paintings, name of Dr. Goswamy has most distinguished place. No one has done the pioneering work that he has done since many years. His innumerable books and articles are most meaningful to understand the knowledge of this field. A special mention needs to be done to several exhibitions that he has curated, and I will speak a little bit about this aspect of his career. Usually when one introduces, one talks about his past education, past associations, and however, though these are necessary, which I'm sure one will get to know from the books and these days from Google, I'll refrain from that. I would like to mention, of course, his recent achievement. One of them is one of the rarest moments in the Indian history, and in particular paintings. Of course, the poster also mentions about him, and that was that he was a recipient of Padma Shri and recently Padma Bhushan, amongst many others. Recently, he curated an exhibition of one of the rarest of the rare paintings of Indian art at the museum Rietberg in Zurich, where some of the most wonderful paintings never seen before were exhibited, and perhaps the exhibition was rare too, which I had a good fortune to see a few months ago, and I'd like to mention about this. Of course, this was his creation. Some of the finest paintings of 16th and 17th century of the country are now in Iran, as these painters came and perhaps took them back. Another equally large collection, as old, in St. Petersburg now, and the third with the Queen of England. The same exhibition now travels to Metropolitan Museum in New York, which is all just open, I was told, but without more or less half of these paintings, and those are the best ones too. These are the masterpieces of the collection, as Iran and USA do not have hostile relations. It didn't go there. I spent around 8 hours, which I think was even less, seeing this wonderful exhibition. And in this exhibition, I have yet to see a comprehensive work such as this ever, and so well explained and giving an insight into this work of Indian paintings. His two-part catalog of 840 pages catalog, co-edited by him, is one of the best I've ever seen, and I would surely recommend each and everyone here to please see them, and if one can afford, please buy them. It is one of the final words on vast and most interesting subject of our country and Indian painting, and about which we are going to hear from one of the most noteworthy scholars of our time, Dr. B.N. Goswamy.
May I say how much of a pleasure it is for me to be here this afternoon, and an honor to speak to colleagues distinguished as yourselves and to young students. I should, however, issue a warning. I have just landed from the United States 2 days ago. I am under jet lag. Ordinarily, speakers put audiences to sleep. In this case, the speaker might go off to sleep in the middle of the lecture. So please bear with me. What am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about something which not only you and I share, but everyone in this world, a sense of wonder. We have in our tradition, in the aesthetic tradition of India, something like 9 rasas we speak of. Shringar, Hasya, Karuna, Raudra, Veer, Bhayanak, and so on. But the highest of the rasas is Adbhuta. Adbhut, sense of wonder, is a rasa, is a sentiment that is considered to be at a level which is much, much higher than any of the other 8 rasas. And what are we talking about? Not ordinary surprise, but wonder at an elevated level. Not hairat, as we call it in Persian, but tahayyur. Not an ordinary surprise, but vismaya, that is what we speak of. Not surprise. So what is it that we talk about when we talk about the Adbhut Rasa? Let me recall for me, for yourselves, a moment when I was a young student in my primary class in a tiny little municipal school in a back of beyond district of Punjab called Gurdaspur. When we were students, we used to sit on the floor on coir matting, as I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And a teacher of ours used to walk up and down between the 2 or 3 rows of this coir matting. And he kept on reciting to himself some poetry. We didn't understand what he was talking about. Like all students, we thought he has gone off his mind, the teacher had. But some words of those poems that he used to recite to himself have stuck in my memory. And 40 years later, as long as 40 years later, I identified those verses which came from the great poet Sir Muhammad Iqbal. What did he speak of? 6 lines, each ending with a question. I'll recite them for you and translate them because you may not know Urdu very well. And I remember I can still close my eyes and hear his voice. Palta hai beech ko matti ki tari ki mein kaun? Kaun daryaon ki maujon se uthata hai sihab? Kaun laya khinch kar pachhim se bade saazgar? Ye zameen kiski hai? Kiska hai ye noor-e aaftab? Aur kisne bhar di motiyon se khoshaye gandum ki jeb? Aur mausamon ko kisne siklai hai khue-e-inqilab? Each line, as I said, ending with a question. Palta hai beech ko matti ki tarike mein kaun? Who is it that is feeding a tiny little seed in the dark depth of the soil? Who is it that raises these enormous clouds from the golden rivers that flow on our land? Who is it that brings these favorable westerly winds in our direction year after year? Ye zameen kiski hai? Who does this earth belong to? Kiska hai ye noor-e aftab? Where does the sun get its brilliance from? And then in the final verses, kisne bhar di motiyon se khoshaye gandum ki jeb? Who is it that studs like pearls, little danas, little grains in the stalk of wheat? And who is it that teaches the seasons? Now it's time for you to go and yield your place to the next one, and so on. Mausamon ko kisne sikhlai hai khue-e-inqilab? Wonderful verses. And essentially raising in your minds and mine this question about the mysterium magnum that this universe is. This great mystery, which you cannot understand, I cannot understand, but you can all make our piddling little attempts to do that. So this sense of wonder, this ability of man to be able to go outside of himself and raise questions, as in the Upanishads we used to do. Kim karomi, ko gacchami, where shall I go, in what direction shall I go, proceed, and so on. That is what the essence of the human endeavor is. That I am convinced of. That I think every thinking person should be convinced of, that there are mysteries to be solved, There are worlds to be explored. There are universes which really need to be get acquainted with, and so on, in that particular fashion. So the sense of wonder is quintessentially a human quality. And if we can keep it alive in ourselves, whether we are children or grown-ups or old people like myself, then I think we are getting somewhere, we are proceeding in the right direction. So what I am going to show you is a selection of slides, selection of images, which I have taken some effort to put together in order to see how the painter of the past of India, whose names we do not know, only we are beginning to discover them at this particular moment of time, how the painter of India experienced a sense of wonder, and how does he try and communicate it to you and to me. These images may not be familiar to you. I understand that you are all architects, but like all human beings who are thinking on their feet and thinking in their minds, we need to nurture constantly this sense of wonder. It is an obligation and a responsibility and a privilege on our part to be able to do that, because we are thinking people, so we believe. So whenever we see an image, whether it is a painting like this or any kind of an image outside of ourselves, whether it's sculpture or architecture and so on and so forth, if it induces in us that sense of wonder, that tahayyur that I spoke of, that sense of vismay, and that not surprise but wonder at an elevated level and so on, then that work of art is performing its function. Let's begin with this image. This image is from a palace in Jaisalmer. I was in Jaisalmer some years ago and I was looking around and I believed that there was a chamber in the palace which had paintings on the walls, but as very often happens in India, the doors of the chamber were locked, the key had been lost, or the man had gone off to attend his mother's funeral or something like this and so on. So we could not do that. I, however, found a little chink in the door, and I've attached my camera to it and took this image. I still do not know. I have no idea at all who these women are that we are seeing on the screen. Are they gopis looking for Krishna? Are they women going out to perform or participate in a festival like the Ganagauri or something like this? Who knows? I have no idea. So I am not left with a sense of wonder about this, but I certainly see this as a failure on my part to get the whole picture. But that is the essence of the situation. We do not get the whole picture ever. When we look at an image like this, it says, leaf from the sketchbook of an artist from Kota. On the better part of the leaf, the greater part of the leaf, what do we have? Scratches, scrawls of different kinds. It is as if the painter is sharpening his brush, bringing it the point to a tip, trying out different pigments and so on, like Jackson Pollock, an Indian Jackson Pollock, if you like, and so on. But when we look at the painting or the leaf a little more closely, you and I discover a figure dancing towards the left of a young boy. Who is it, you and I can ask? Krishna? Who knows? There is no indication. The skin of the color is not indicated. There is no mor mukut. There is no pitambar. So who could it be? We could be left wondering about this. But when we move a little back towards the back, and we see a number of young women who are playing upon instruments, making music, clapping their hands, then the picture becomes a little clearer. Perhaps it's a holy festival. Perhaps it is Krishna who has his companions dancing or making music behind him and so on. We don't know. What am I saying? What I am saying simply is this, that very often there is something elusive in works of art, something we cannot fully grasp immediately, but the attempt that we make may be worth making. This image, which is not a great work of art, but it is intriguing as a work of art. A painter has thought of playing a game with you and me. There are four bodies of deer and one head, and it depends upon what point of view you and I adopt. If we attach that head to the deer standing at right, it fits perfectly well. If you attach it to the deer seated on the floor, on the ground, it works well too. We can do that to deer at the left. We can't do it very well to the deer which is upside down, so to speak, and so on. But somehow or the other, this is a kind of a picture which is startling. It doesn't lead us to that extraordinary elevated sense of wonder with which I began to speak about. But when we come to this, then we know that we are in the presence of a great work of art. This image, which you are looking at, is very often published as the speaking tree. The speaking tree refers to an episode in the great text called the Sikandarnama, in which the story of the life of Alexander is given. Alexander is not only a warrior, not only a conqueror, but also a philosopher king. And when, according to that particular story or that particular text, he arrived in the course of his travels, at a little island called Wak Wak, where he saw a tree which had the same name as the name of the island, Wak Wak. And from that tree hung a large number of figures of animals, birds, human beings, all of them speaking at the same time in a tongue that Alexander could not understand. So it is a symbol of our inadequacy, a symbol of our inability to understand what really is going on out here. But just imagine, the painter had not seen it, you have not seen it, I had not seen it. Maybe Alexander did not see it either. So the painter is left to his own resources, to his own creative powers, to create an image which induces in you and me that heightened sense of wonder. What is it that we are looking at? What is it that the painter is envisioning for you and for me? If you notice, when we get closer, there is no tree. The trunk of the tree is made up of intertwining snakes. There is no wood, there is no bark that you and I see. And the figures which are hanging from there, I mean, we can make out the heads of this animal, this woman, that man, and so on. But constantly, everywhere you see, there is something to surprise us, something to lead us towards a sense of great wonder. If you notice, it is these snakes which turn into branches, toward the right, toward the top, and so on and so forth. If you notice carefully, then towards the bottom right of the image, there are these four fish which have come from somewhere and are arranged in this particular fashion. There's no petal, no flower on this particular bush. It is all heads of different animals. You are reminded of painters like Hieronymus Bosch of Europe, for instance, right? There is a dreamlike quality about this particular image. But if Alexander stood in front of this tree and wondered, that he could not understand a word of what was being uttered by all these creatures caught up or hanging from that particular tree. Then we understand that the painter has got himself into this mode of thinking and envisioning and, above all, of wondering. It's one of the most remarkable images from Mughal India of the 17th century. But that's not what I'm talking about. It's not art history that I'm concerned with. Dates and schools, etc., at this moment of time do not interest me. I just am interested in seeing how the mind of the painter worked. This is an amusing, but also a very interesting image. What do we see? A painting which is split up into three registers. The top register has poetry, then the middle register has a young woman seated, and the bottom register, as we'll see the details. This young woman, who's a Nayaka, a young woman in love, we can understand that, and she's preparing herself to meet the lover, apparently. Who could it be? Is it Radha? We don't know. We cannot be sure of. But she's obviously preparing herself. With the help of her companions and her servants and so on, one of them is holding up a mirror, the other one is bringing some betel leaves, the third one is massaging the soles of her feet and so on. And she's turning back to talk to one companion, asking perhaps, am I now properly ready? And in the lower part of the picture, the lowest part, suddenly all women have magically disappeared except she, and she sits in this grove looking at herself in a mirror. But suddenly, the poet tells us, suddenly she sees not only her own reflection in the mirror, but another face. She's facing in this direction, expecting the lover to come to this particular point from that direction, but the lover has played a trick upon her, come from behind, and it is his face which is reflected in that mirror. And she says to herself, the poet says, have I gone mad? He is so much a part of my thoughts that I cannot see myself alone in a mirror anymore. That's where the poet leaves us. Now, these games that the painter and the poet play, the manner in which the painter picks up the subtlety of the poetry that is inscribed at the top and so on, are meaningful to me. This is the way it proceeds. Unless we look at these things with a certain measure of intensity and engagement, we are liable to miss the entire point. If you look at this Nayaka, this young woman, who's seated on a chamber, in a chamber on a comfortable looking bed, but she is a virahini. She's separated in love, her husband or lover is away, but she expects him to come back. You can see that her head is slightly downwardly inclined. You can see that her gaze is directed more or less at the half open door towards the extreme left. But what is equally interesting and important is that just below her bed, on the bed, if you notice, there's a beautiful garland of flowers pulsating with a life of its own. But there is a candle stand with two candles burning on top of it, a symbol of waiting. But if you look at the wall behind her, on the wall there are niches in which the same candle stand stands. It is like a hall of mirrors, a sheesh mahal in which she is seated. And it is the reflection of the candle stand which is a symbol of longing and waiting that we see in the mirrors on the wall, in the five niches below and the five niches above, like this. At every step, the painter surprises not only us, but himself. And that is of the essence as far as understanding what resides in a work of art. The more we see, the more we understand. the more we understand, the more we really grasp the intent of the artist in this particular fashion. This is something which I would urge you to see for yourselves, because these paintings that I want to show you are in the Sarabhai Foundation here in Ahmedabad. Pichwais. This great Pichwai relates to what is called Varsha Ritu. This is a big painting on cloth, and it's wonderful, I mean, in its richness. And in the Varsha Ritu Pichwais, very often Krishna himself is not seen, but the gopis have arrived at this beautiful spot, fragrant and strewn with flowers, wonderful clouds in the sky, and golden trees everywhere, but Krishna is not there. Between the three gopis at the right and the three at the left, there is a tree which becomes, in a certain sense, a symbol of Krishna, who is absent. But notice this, in the background, behind these gopis, there are all kinds of decorative patterns, including flowers, which seem to be falling from the trees above. We see this again and again. In the background, similarly, in the same place, Sarabhai Foundation, there is this Pichwai. There are three women to the right, three to the left, and the background is completely strewn with flowers. This Pichwai is also there. But it's a Pichwai with a difference. I must have seen this Pichwai 20 times, or maybe 50 times. One day when I was taking a group of my friends in the Sarabhai Foundation, the Calico Museum, I saw something different. And that is that the flowers in the background are all gone, except directly under the tree, around the trunk of the tree, and the flowers seem to have been arranged in a fashion. This is the part detailed of this. Now look at this from a little closer. I could see the figure of Krishna. If you join the ends of these flowers, like you join ends of, you know, dots in a painting book and so on, you can see Krishna himself. Legs crossed, body slightly bent, flute in hand. What did the painter have in his mind? That somebody 200 years after he had painted this will be able to recognize that this is what I have done, this is what I have achieved. I'm sure you can see the feet with a lightly crossed towards the bottom and so on, and the body moving like this. Now that, for me, was a moment of revelation. Hidden things, nuances, hints of different kinds thrown in our direction by the painter. The world of painting is filled with these things. Some painter in Jodhpur seems to have had the idea of creating an image in three parts of how creation began. How did creation begin? With nothingness, absolute nothingness, void as it were. And then suddenly a figure appears on that, figure of Nathji as it is called, and then earth appears like this and so on. The act of the world coming into being as imagined or envisioned by a painter. Now these are not ordinary images. These are products of thought. Chitta Sangya, as we call it. The activity of the mind. And not only of the eyes or of the hand. So if the word chitta and chitra come from the same source, if chitra is an activity of the mind, then we start understanding that much more thought has gone into the making of these images than we give the painter very often credit. credit for. These are not things to be taken too lightly. The same painter from Jodhpur starts then waxing eloquent. How did Brahma emerge from the navel of Vishnu as he lay on the endless waters of eternity? Like this. First there is only a seed in the heart of the flower, and then Brahma appears over there. He is tracing for us, for you and me, the beginnings of time and the beginnings of eternity. It is not an easy matter for you and I to engage in an activity of this particular kind, to close our eyes and see what is, how could it have happened, to visualize it to the extent that we as poor humans can do. So this is the way in which it keeps on moving in the hand of a very gifted group of painters who were active in Jodhpur in the 19th century. What could this be? It's a complete page. What could this be? Are these clouds stylized? Are these rocks? Are these waves? What are these? I don't have an answer. I hope you have. But this is the way in which the fertile mind of the painter envisions and brings into being wondrous images of this kind. Suddenly the color of these changes. Suddenly from those bluish gray to these pinkish red and so on and so forth, the same rocks or clouds or whatever they are appear before our eyes. These are not the work of hack artists. This is not the work of a painter who keeps on repeating himself. These are products of thought. And we have to see them. Now the clouds like this do not encounter your eyes and mine. We do not have the eyes to see them. But a painter does have it. Does have the ability to conjure into being images of this description. The painters were not afraid of taking on cosmic visions. The Vishwarupa of Krishna, which appeared, which Krishna revealed to Arjuna on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, as we all know, in the 11th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So it is a daunting thing when Arjuna sees that he nearly goes blind with the dazzling light that he sees. Oh Lord, if the light of 1,000 suns were to be piled upon 1,000 suns, it will not match the effulgence which comes from your body. Like that. There are countless arms, countless legs, countless heads, sahasra murdha, sahasrapad, and so on and so forth. So the text says. So the painter, in his own limited manner, but a courageous manner, envisions an image like this, or like this. Wherever you see, there are worlds to be discovered in this Vishwarupa of Vishnu and Krishna. What looks like from a distance eyes are the sun and the moon. What looks like a golden crown on the head is the Vaikuntha Dham of Krishna Vishnu. Everywhere in the Vakshasthala, on the shoulders, wherever you see, there are what emerging from the nostrils are winged angels and so on and so forth. So the painter has really immersed himself into the thought of creating an image of great cosmic proportions that the Bhagavad Gita speaks of. It's an act of courage. Not only an act of imagination, but to delve into this vision is not the easiest thing in the world for ourselves. It's not a miscellany of images that I'm sharing with you. It is images which are born of conviction. When in the Ramayana, Hanuman takes to the skies flies like this, then you and I can close our eyes and see him sailing through the vast expanse of blue above ourselves. But when Hanuman goes to these mountain tops to bring the Sanjeevani booty, as we know from the Ramayana, then we see him as a tiny little figure up towards the top. And then when he has picked up the relevant portion of that particular mountain, we see him towards the top right, flying through the skies. First he identifies the herb, then he flies through the skies. But the painter is not satisfied only with that. He wants us to look at something slightly different also. He gives us a view of what is down below, and just cloud after bank of cloud appears to give us some sense of the vast expanse of space into which he has entered. The Rasalila of Krishna and the gopis. When you and I see this image, at the center is Krishna with his favorite, and there is a circle of dancers around them, but all women. But in the same painting, Krishna multiplies himself, and between two gopis, he appears again and again and again, having multiplied, having expanded from within outward, so to speak. But when we see the whole image, it is on the same page. One circle towards the left, in which Krishna is with the favorite gopi in the center, and this one at the right, which is essentially like one gopi, one Krishna, gopi, Krishna, and so on and so forth. But what do the two circles look like? Like the wheels of some cosmic chariot which keeps moving. Look at this painting with some care. How much thought might have gone into this? From the Ramayana, Ram, Lakshman and Sita are exiles and they are crossing the Ganga in a boat. The story is that when Ram, Lakshman and Sita were taken across the waters of the Ganga by the kevat, by the boatman, then at the end of that journey, Rama said to the kevat, "I can't offer you much. I'm an exile." Sita started taking off her bangles, but the boatman said, "You don't owe me anything at all because we are in the same profession. I am a boatman taking you across the Ganga, but you are the one who is going to take us across the ocean of sorrow that this particular world is, the Bhavasagar, which we have to cross." Professional courtesy of one boatman towards another. Otherwise, if that were not in the mind of the painter, why would he fill the entire page with just a vast expanse of water, and the heroes of the image, heroes of the episode, are reduced only to a tiny little sliver towards the top and so on? It certainly had crossed his mind. These are the figures we can see, Ram, Lakshman and Sita in that. But in the complete painting, they are only up there in that tiny little area over there. The thought must have crossed the painter's mind. Let me turn the Ganga into an image of the great ocean of sorrow eventually. So what are we looking at? Essentially, acts of imagination and things which force you and me to wonder about it all, about this mysterium magnum that I spoke of to begin with. Wherever we go, in whatever direction we look, any image from the selection that I am showing you. There are amazing things to be discovered. Krishna lifting the Mount Govardhan on this little finger of his left hand and holding it aloft for 7 days as Indra pours all his fury upon the earth, and the village kinsmen and so on seek shelter under that great mountain, Govardhan. But look at the details of this. Wonder, fear, consternation, written every face, whether it is this group or the group at the left. There are all kinds of emotions that you see, experience, witness. But up there in the sky, helplessly, Indra on his Airavat elephant mount rages, impotent against the powers of Krishna. So if you and I are familiar with the episode, if you and I are sahriday of the same heart as the painter who is envisioning this and so on, then we are probably deserving of taking from the work of art what essentially resides in it. At the beginning of the Krishnavatar, when all gods assemble before the Kshir Sagar, there are the munis and the sages and so on and so forth, and the prithvi as cow, because go means both prithvi and a cow, so they all are waiting for Vishnu to incarnate himself, begging him to appear like this. And we see him completely covered by the milky waters of the ocean in which he sleeps. It's not a simple painting to paint. It is not an easy thing to address ourselves to. But the painter knows exactly what he's doing. That sense of mystery which the people assembled on the bank of the ocean are experiencing, he's bringing within your reach and mine. Kaliyamardhan, again under the waters, but Krishna battling the serpent Kaliya like this. These are works of great, not only craftsmanship and skill, but works possessed of great depth and conviction. Just look at this. The sense of wonder which Akrura experiences, brought within your reach and mind by the painter. Akrura has come to take Krishna and Balaram to Mathura to participate in the festival that Kansa is holding. And on the bank of the river Yamuna, Akrur says to Krishna and Balaram, it's hot, I'm also a bit thirsty, can we take a bit of rest and can I take a dip in the waters? So he leaves Krishna and Balaram in the chariot up there and he goes under the waters to have a dip. And as he enters the waters, this is Krishna and Balaram up there, as he enters the water, he suddenly sees Krishna and Balaram underwater. And then he is surprised and baffled. And he raises his head again. Outside the water, see, I just left them on the bank. How can they be under the water out here? And then he dips again. And this time he sees Vishnu on the Shesha Shaya. Shesha being Balaram, Vishnu being Krishna. And then he realizes, these are no ordinary young boys that I am taking to Mathura, but divinity itself. This adbhut experience that he has is what the painter in his own fashion has also experienced. And you and I, if we are interested in this, if we are sahriday, might also experience. Leaf after leaf in Indian painting brings this within our reach, just about within our reach. Look at this wondrous thing that is rising into the skies. This is the Vimana, the Pushpaka, in which Rama and Sita and Lakshmana to return to Ayodhya after Lanka has been conquered. And when the poet says, when the Vimana took off into the air, the citizens of Lanka came out to see at this extraordinary spectacle rising into like a great mansion taking into the skies. And there is the Vimana, seven storied high. And there is Rama and Sita at the very top. And Rama is pointing out, this is where this happened, this is where this happened to Sita. And around them, there is this extraordinary spectacle of clouds parting, birds screeching, whether in this direction or in that direction. So collected together, the citizens of Lanka downstairs, on the ground, the Viman there, the clouds parting, the birds taking to wing and so on, is all something that makes us participate in that sense of wonder, which must have been experienced by the characters involved. I'll try and shorten it. I can understand that time is not on your side or mine. But let me quickly take you through the group of slides or images that I have chosen. Sense of wonder again. A demon by the name of Trinavarta comes to pick up the baby Krishna and kill him. But he is a demon, but not in a human form, in the form of a whirlwind. How does the painter enter the whirlwind? Is this a tree? Are these flames towards the right that you and I are looking at? But in the midst of those flames or that tree or whatever it is, Krishna is dancing as a baby. And when up there we see him, but he masters the Trinavarta demon, and when he comes down, then Yashoda, his mother, who is afraid, mortally filled with fear, he says, why were you afraid? You thought I was going to be killed? Not by this demon, not by any demon. Sense of wonder again. From the Bhagavad Purana, one day a demon comes in the form of a great big reptile which they had never seen, Krishna or the Gopas, and he opens his mouth this wide, and everyone thinks this is a new road or something like this, a new cave, let's explore it, and they start entering the road or the cave from the bottom right, as you could see. And when you see them there, entering, you can see the fangs of the demon. You can see the look of confidence in his eyes that he's going to capture them and kill Krishna. Everyone has gone inside, cows and gopas and so on, Krishna and Balaram bringing up the rear. But when they are caught inside, then Krishna says to them, why are we? The demon closes his mouth, so they are in that cavern. Krishna says, let's make an effort. Let's try and break open the palate of the mouth of the demon. And then they do that. And then he dies. And now contrast the look in the eyes. No teeth anymore. Have all fallen out. The look is that of a piteous animal. But within the same frame, I'll take you there. The same frame. It's the same demon whom we see once and a second time. But how imaginatively the painter disposes them, composes the image, and so on, is the thing to be seen. When Prithvi runs like a cow, and the first of the kings, Prithu, after whom Prithvi is named, captures the cow, he brings the cow back into his chamber and calls all creatures, come, take from the earth what you can. So animals and serpents and all kinds of creatures assemble to pick from the earth, which is in the form of a cow, what they are capable of receiving. I am quite certain that images like this will not easily be forgotten by anyone who has looked at them with any degree of care or intensity. Burning mountain from the Bhagavad Purana, from a Mysore manuscript. The mountain has caught fire. The burning of the forest. And when the forest is being burnt by the Pandavas, then Agni is called in. Agni lights the fire, but Indra does not like that, so he throws down rain. So the fire goes out again and again and again. And then the Pandavas ask Arjun to help. And Arjun says, I am going to throw up arrows at such speed that they will form a canopy and water will not fall on the ground. And that canopy that you can see towards the top. Wondrous deed, wondrously rendered by a painter. How is the earth conceived of by a painter? Layer upon layer upon layer. These are the imaginations of a Mysore painter of the rings that make up this particular earth and so on. A great big whirlwind in the Ramayana we see in this particular fashion. The Ganga taking its route across the as Bhagirath moves and the Ganga follows him, Ganga Avataran and so on, like this and so forth. As I said, these are not ordinary images. As five sadhakas start looking for Shiva on Kailash and they go through strange landscapes that you and I are looking at, entering cave after cave, icy peaks and so on, and finding Shivalingas everywhere, worshipping them. Then they get on top of that icy peak and so on and see that there is a golden land in front of their eyes. And then they keep on moving in that direction. We have to get into the skin, under the skin of the painter who's painted this extraordinary series of the Kedar Kalpa that you and I are looking at now. There are elements of great abstraction. There are distortions. There are deliberate departures from observation, but all in the interest of bringing us close to the sense of wonder that these sadhakas are experiencing themselves. And finally they reach Kailash. And finally it is Kartikeya who is listening to what his father Shiva is speaking. That is Shiva and Parvati. A mental pilgrimage performed by a sadhaka. Mental pilgrimage. What are these four oval shapes that we, you and I, are looking at, in which there are all kinds of creatures and crisscrosses of streams and so on and so forth? I can't understand that. Are these four Shivalingas on the top of which a flower has been placed? What is it that the painter is showing? This man seated with another little plant or some leaves, maybe of the bilva tree, which is going to place on the top of one of these. I do not understand everything that is there in these paintings. I understand very, very little. And I am aware of the fact that so much of it is eluding you and me. But each time I see images of this description, I am moved. I am deeply impressed by the ability of the painter to create images of this level and with this sense of conviction. Let me take you through this painting. Uddhava, Krishna's friend, comes back to Vrindavana and says to the gopis, forget about Krishna, he's not going to return. He has told me he is not going to return. And the gopis are incensed. And Uddhav says, no, no, you should think of higher things. And the women say, what nonsense are you talking about? What philosophy? There's no such thing as philosophy in our lives. We are deeply in love with Krishna. And he promised us that he will come back here. So Uddhav, man nahi das bees, they say. We don't have 20 hearts or 10 hearts. We had only one heart. And that Krishna has taken. Now that is the moment which the painter picks up to describe. I'll take you through this painting in some detail. These are the women who are, that is Uddhav towards the extreme left. And these women are asking questions of each other. And one of them points out, look, the footprints of Krishna are still there. He has left them as a promise of return. What are you talking about? And one of them says, all right, you might be able to speak to us of your fine philosophy, but come, I'll show you something. You can explain something to us, and we might just understand what you are telling us. But what are you going to be able to tell that cow which stands there waiting for Krishna to return? Is that a cloud in the sky that we see towards the left? Is that a rock on which the cow is standing looking in the direction from which Krishna might return? It's difficult to determine. Very difficult to determine. But moving, the simplicity of it, the honesty of it, the conviction of it, to me, are deeply moving. This sense of wonder runs like a golden thread through the paintings of India. We have no idea what this image is about. Krishna and Arjuna starts off towards the extreme left, and ring upon ring of different landscapes, different terrains, they pass through. We can see them setting off. There are seven oceans to be crossed, seven mountains to be gotten over. But we don't know exactly what episode this is. Everywhere there are different worlds. Everywhere there are different characters that we see. And finally, when they emerge, at the end of all that, there is a golden light, brilliant and shining and dazzling, which encounters them. The journey that Krishna and Arjuna are performing, setting from the extreme left and moving towards an area, the text says, then there was light and nothing else but light. I'll end with this image. What is it that you and I are seeing? Hiranyagarbha, the golden seed, beginnings of creation, on the waters of endless, shoreless reality, appeared the golden germ. Is it golden? I don't know, but this is the magic of Indian painting. You hold it in your hand, because these are small pictures, and you move it ever so slightly, and it will start shining like this. So you participate in the act of seeing. It is not a passive act, but you are in a certain sense manipulating the picture in your hand, and a different aspect of it reveals itself. To me, this is sorcery. This is magic that the painter is capable of bringing into being. At each step, at each turn, he surprises us and sows the seed of that consuming curiosity which great poetry, great painting, great literature consists of. I'll end with two verses of the great Urdu poet Faiz Ahmad Faiz. In the beginning of one of his ghazals, there are two couplets, and it's all about curiosity, all about the desire to know more and more. Kai baar iski khatir zarre zarre ka jigar cheera, magar ye chashme hairan jiski hairani nahi jaati. Aur kai baar iska daman bhar diya husne do alam se, magar dil hai ki iski khana veerani nahi jaati. Countless times have I taken an atom and sliced it again, and yet my eyes keep wondering, what else could there be inside it? What am I missing? Countless times have I taken the wealth of the two worlds and poured it into the lap of my heart. Magar dil hai ki iski khana veerani nahi jaati. But my heart somehow manages to remain empty. It is looking for more and more and still more. That is what great poetry, great painting consists of. This is where I will end, but not before thanking you for the kindness you have shown me in being so patient. Thank you very much. I would have shown you a series of images that I have of fire, for instance. Seven different treatments of fire. One painter sees it in one fashion, the other one another fashion, third one a different fashion. It's a very, very instructive series to go through. Or seven images of clouds, unaware of each other, completely unaware, from different, because one of them is living in the 16th century, the other one in the 18th. One of them is in Rajasthan, the other one in the Pahadi area, or something like this. I'm not saying that there is no contact between painters of the same generation. There were contacts, but most of these images that you and I have been seeing are standalone images.
But in terms of Mughal ones, the great Shahjahan, Jahangir, did they, the earlier ones, probably saw some of those early ones, or they had any reference?
No, the Mughal painters, let's say the Mughal situation is somewhat different. First of all, the Mughal painting sort of spreads from 1550 to about 1675 or so. So it's a period of 125 years. But let's say at the court of Jahangir, there are a number of painters active at the same time. So there must have been some exchanges. Some people come from the same family, like Balchand and Payag are brothers, and so on. Like Abul Hasan and Abid are brothers, and sons of Akhariza, like that. So there is some contact, some connection. But each one is plowing his own furrow. That is the interesting thing. Thank you for no more questions. Thank you very much.
Sir, Goswami ji, if there are no questions, the fault is your own. Through different languages and different shailis, you have created a sort of a magic web, and we are lost in wonder. And I think this is one of the most profound experiences of wonder that we have experienced in a long time here. And thanking you would not be the right thing, but still, it is coming from the depth of our hearts. We thank you for sharing with us, both young and old, this sense of wonder, which is increasingly rare in the world. Thank you very much, sir. And on behalf of the Alumni Association, one of our younger students will offer you a little bit of a symbol of our appreciation, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you all for being with us today also. Thank you.